to the Nevadebla world.
Seriously?
That's a new one.
Yeah. I'm trying to mix it up so we're not just doing the same fucking thing every week. I mean, should we do the same fucking thing every week? Because we can start over and I can off-blast us.
No, it's
too late. You can't just do the off-blast when you've already, you know, done the Welcome to the Nevy Double.
It's too late to off-blast now. Look what you did.
It is never too late to off-blast.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, we'll accept that for the time being.
I'm so flattered. Your validation means the world to me.
You're not validated. You need to go get your parking sticker. And
you guys just validated me. Don't try to take it back.
Good times. All right, folks, everybody, welcome to another wonderful edition of NevyCast. This is your boy, Fearless Billy Nuwanda, who dated, 10,000 women all at the same time while scoring a triple-double. And who also...
Is that in the butt?
Yeah.
It's the shocker.
Obviously.
He did the shocker with his penis.
Oh, my God.
But was it skinny, though?
You would be the expert on the dimensions of your own penis, I
thought. we're already off to a great start. And, of course, sitting off in the distance, our master of board and adventure games.
It's Rum. What's up? Yeah, I'm short and sweet. I just like to get...
Brevity is the soul of wit, man. Move on.
You defeated the point just by explaining that you're short and sweet.
Okay. I'm mostly sweet.
And salty.
Oh!
And of course, next to Rum.
It's Ellie. I am not dying this week. I had the flu. Turns out it was not a sinus infection after all, and I sound so much better, I think.
Bronchitis, too.
Yeah, I had bronchitis and the flu. So...
Back to full hungies.
Yes.
Hungies.
Hungies!
And of course, our next to Ellie, our wonderful delivery man, it's Eugene, everybody.
Eugene. Yeah. Renamed. Recently renamed, if you paid attention to our Pathfinder game. Our DM kept calling him Eugene over and over again.
Yeah, even though my name is my name, actually,
His character's name is his real name, and he kept getting called Eugene.
Eugene.
so you are now Eugene, the delivery man.
Yeah, I am. All right. if it may be, so I'll accept it.
That's like the sullen acceptance right there.
Yeah.
And, of course, next to our delivery man is our master of Edo horror and really great, looking coifs of hair. It's Hans, everybody.
Well, hello there. How are you this evening?
Okay.
You doing some Vincent Price
good.
Shit?
How you doing? How's everybody else doing?
I was asking our audience, aww. You twit.
Alright.
Good times with weapons.
We're off to a great start.
Yeah, we already are, so we'll dive straight into some gaming hotness. So, yeah, everybody's got Persona 5, they're enjoying the shit out of it, and they want to share it, but guess what? You can't fucking share that shit natively on PS4.
What?
Yeah, they blocked it.
That's so weird.
But
why?
No, the rabbit hole goes even deeper. Because as you know, for a lot of people who can't, when you can't share natively through PS4, you bypass it through Elgato gaming device, which is like a little deal that... you plug into your console through that, and then it feeds to your PC, and you can then use, OBN to... Or Open Broadcasting Software.
OBS.
Yeah.
You can use OBS, stream directly to Twitch and whatnot, with all kinds of fancy filters and stuff. Well, Atlas put out a notice a couple days ago about Persona 5 and streaming, basically stating that... You're only allowed to record to a certain day. You can only record certain battles. And that if you break any of those deals, if you try to stream past that, or if you try to stream any other battles beyond that, you will be hit with full copyright strikes and your YouTube channel will be taken down.
That is so awful.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
It's about like how Nintendo tried to get everybody to sign up for their... you had to be on their list of approved people to stream their stuff.
It's so dumb.
Yeah.
It's like it's another one of those classic cases of, you know, like, because, like, in the letter, Atlas USA was making it very, 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 very clear that it was their Japanese masters that were the ones behind it. And it's just, it's another one of those cases where you have a Japanese company that is just completely out of touch with, you know, modern gaming. Which, I mean, modern gaming nowadays is about streaming and about, you know, folks, like, trying to push the game out there and spread it socially. So it's kind of like, you know, like,
that's
really?
Free, that's pretty much free advertising for them.
It really is, and you know, like, this isn't, like, if it's, like, that much about control, like, it's just, like, I hate to say it, but it's just, like, if you're going to be that much of a dick about it, like, why, or do you really, why should you even put your game out? You know?
You're scaring off the fans.
Yeah.
Shit on it, it's fans.
I will forever be bitter about that fucking pachinko machine.
Yes.
Oh my god.
What about PT?
That's what I'm saying. That's what they gave us. Instead of Silent Hills, they're like, oh, where's a fucking Silent Hill pachinko machine instead?
Yeah. Not to be confused with the upcoming Metal Gear Solid pachinko machine and slots.
Yeah. And don't forget the mobile game.
Sluts.
Yeah.
Oh god, mobile games.
Yeah. So they completely left the whole console gaming and PC gaming stuff. They're going straight mobile and pachinko. That's it.
So wait, they axed their terrible idea for Metal Gear Survive?
No, that shit's still going on. Because I believe it's going to be Gacha.
Of course.
So, yeah. But yeah, I mean, it's just like, it's one of those deals where it's just like, a lot of these Japanese companies wonder why, especially with the PS3 360 generation, seeing this, like, gigantic renaissance of Western game development studios all of a sudden not only take the reins, but just completely engulf all of gaming nowadays. And now, like, all these Japanese companies are kind of being forced into more niche positions. And some can make it work. Like, you know, Platinum Games is a really great example. The guys behind Bayonetta and
Mad World,
Wonderful 101. But
Platinum did Wonderful 101?
Yeah. Yeah, that was, like, one of Kamiya's, like, brainchilds right there.
I did not know that.
Yep. I have a feeling Wonderful 101 was probably part of the deal to get Bayonetta on the Wii U.
Probably.
Very
possible.
Yeah, so it's just kind of like, some can make it work, but, like, this whole deal with Atlas lately is just kind of like, again, you know, just, like, it lessens my desire to play Persona. Mm-hmm. You know, because it's just like,
they're scaring you off.
Yeah. Because, like, you know, it's just like, well, you know, like, I understand that it's a very, like, narrative-heavy game, but if you're going to do a narrative-heavy game and you're afraid of folks spoiling your shit, like they voiced in the article, you might want to put your game out a little bit sooner than 7 months after the Japanese release.
Oh my god, I didn't know it was that fucking long after.
And it kind of reminds me of the whole Bethesda thing where they, what was it that, they weren't allowing people to pre-play the game anymore. They have to all play it at the same time. I think that was when Dishonored 2 came out or something. I don't know. I can't remember the exact thing, but it was something like where Bethesda put out a rule saying that people can't pre-play a game if they get early access, whatever.
Yeah, there's stuff like that. I mean, that's part of the ZeniMax arm of Bethesda, though.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, I mean, like, usually, like, I mean, I'll say this much about Bethesda. It's like, as a game studio, they're fun, if buggy. But ZeniMax, their lawyer arm, the one that, like, is the corporate side of Bethesda,
yeah,
really just fucking sucks dealing with. And I know some friends of mine will disagree because they're really tight with, like, id Software and whatnot. But, yeah, just from an outsider's perspective, it's just, like, some of the things that ZeniMax does just, like, makes me shake my head sometimes. The only exception being what's going on with John Carmack. And, like, that was 100% Carmack deserved that shit.
Yeah. All I'm saying is Todd Howard needs to finally come out and say something about the new Elder Scrolls game this year at E3. That'd be fucking great.
Well, no, he needs to hurry.
Do you want
to
play Skyrim on another console?
I was going to say,
I need to breathe.
I need to play Skyrim on 7 different things, please. Yes.
Now, I have the 360 version, the PC version, the special edition version.
Oh my god.
I don't have it on PS4, though.
Yeah, we'll see. I was thinking about getting it on PS4 until I heard it was going to be on Switch. And I'm just kind of like, okay, portable Skyrim, I'm sold. Maybe I'll actually...
You're the only one of this entire group that
has a Switch.
Has a Switch and is liking the Switch. I will never touch the damn thing.
Again, as soon as they announce No More Heroes 3, I'm sold on a Switch.
Or Monster Hunter, Triple Cross.
It does feel like a triple cross.
Yeah, it does feel like a triple cross at that. But yeah. Moving on.
Speaking of Monster Hunter, Frontier Z is coming out on PS4. Of course, there's no word on a North American release because we will never actually locally get to play Frontier. Because fuck us, Gaijin.
Yeah, but at the same token, though, isn't Frontier really super grindy? That's generally the impressions I've heard from like Apex and Gaijin Hunter.
But that's nearly any Monster Hunter game.
Yeah, I mean, like, don't get me wrong, like, grinding is one of the hallmarks of Monster Hunter. I mean, God knows how many hours you spend just trying to get to high rank. But the same token, like, I don't know. Like, I don't know if I could spend 500 hours just to get the low rank Tetsukabra armor set. That makes any sense.
That's why I always go from Bone to Rathian. But yes, I would in a heartbeat. Localized Frontier, Capcom. Adding my voice to the throng.
LOL.
Voice is not the thong.
Thong, 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 thong.
Hey!
Hey. How many games of Hunter? Hunters or Hunter? Yeah.
How many games of the...
Hunter
that Hunter.
I was getting ready to say, I thought you were about ready to say Hunter x Hunter, and I was just like,
the Hunter
what?
Boy. The Hunter Boy game.
No, as you can tell, I'm not a gamer at all.
Well, you are a little bit. You just do a lot of fighting games.
Yeah, I do.
But, yeah, like, no, Monster Hunter has been going, let's see, this is like...
Since 2005.
2005. Okay. Wow. First one was on PlayStation 2. Second, like the other ones, a lot of them, well, Hobbs can be is a more Monster Hunter historian than I am, so why don't you give this rundown?
DOS was also on PS2, which that only got a Japanese release. We finally got a version of it with, I believe, Monster Hunter Freedom, which was essentially Monster Hunter DOS, but called something different on the PSP and released in English.
Because it's America.
And the thing is, something has to sell PSPs because they really don't sell themselves. Yeah. So mostly hacking them and Monster Hunter sold PSPs in as far as they actually sold. Then Nintendo got a hold of it for the third generation. We had Try on the Wii, and then we had, we also had Try on the 3DS.
Yeah, because around the time of the 3DS, like in the Wii U, they put out Monster Hunter Tri Ultimate. Because I remember that one, because I picked that one up.
Mm-hmm. Tri Ultimate on the Wii U. And then they had Monster Hunter 4 on the 3DS exclusively. And then they had Generations on the 3DS exclusively. And now they're probably going to release Double Cross on the 3DS stateside, as I do believe they've already done so in Japan.
Yeah, it's already out. I've watched a lot of Gaijin Hunter and Apex's stuff on it, and it looks pretty radical.
Well, we finally get a G-rank from it, plus we get the Brave hunting style.
And the Alchemist.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, the Alchemist cat?
No, just the Alchemist style.
Oh. Yeah, they don't really talk up that one because it doesn't look half as glorious when you, instantly counter a charging Rathalos.
Yeah.
So yeah, when you have half the group over here, just staring huh?
Well, I'm thinking, so where are you now? Like, what fucking game are you playing now?
Me? I'm still on Breath of the Wild.
What fucking game you playing, motherfucker?
Monster Hunter, I mean. Like, which
Monster Hunter,
cleared Generations we're waiting for Double Cross.
Yeah, I think, at this point, the only thing I have left to do in Generations is the last set of DLC that had come out. Because we stopped around the time that the second to last DLC set came out. This is mainly because it gave Star Rook.
Yeah, was that the Savage Devil Joe?
Yeah, that was Savage Devil Bro.
And that's Generation?
Mm-hmm.
Generations, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so after that, it's Double Cross?
Double Cross in Japan.
Technically. Yeah. Because Monster Hunter Generations in North America is Monster Hunter Cross in Japan.
Okay.
So naturally, for the expansion, they would call it Double Cross. I don't know if they're going to continue calling it Generations or Double Generations or Generations G is probably the Occam's Razor approach.
Did I hear you say Triple Cross a while ago?
It's a joke. Oh. It was a joke because, like one of the general things we were thinking is that they might just do a port over to Switch.
Like an ultimate version for the quote-unquote home console like they did with third generation and try Ultimate on the Wii U.
Okay, so that would be the game for the Switch if it comes out.
Yeah.
Theoretically.
Right.
Since we've not heard anything about it, we're just kind of theorizing here.
Right, okay.
Yeah. Like I said, right now all we're waiting on is for them to, if I imagine they're going to do it, they're going to do it at E3, announce the localization of Double Cross. Because, I mean, like, right now Monster Hunter has actually grown quite a bit with Nintendo helping them out. And, like, it would be foolish not to localize it at this point.
Mm-hmm. Well, the reason why I bring it up is that I found an anime that came out based on that game.
Monster Hunter Crap. Yeah. Painfully shown.
I know. It's so bad.
Is it for children?
It's for
children. Yeah.
Yeah, it's for children. Of course it's going to
suck. Well, okay, I'll give some backstory on this one. The anime that everybody is referencing is called Monster Hunter Stories Ride On, which is actually based upon a really decent RPG version of Monster Hunter developed by Level 5, the guys behind the Professor Layton series and a lot of other good classics. Capcom hired them to go ahead and develop an RPG for it. That would be kind of like like my first Monster Hunter kind of situation.
Babby's first Monster Hunter.
Babby's first Monster Hunter. And like,
just
it's
have them fight a Kutku for 3 hours.
Yeah,
there you go.
It's a shame because like this.
What
game,
is that? Describe it to me.
The Kutku is a giant bird, chicken, wyvern piece of shit that is essentially your first entry test into Monster Hunter.
It's like an ostrich.
Kind of,
but lizardy.
Okay.
Think lizardy,
a lizardy ostrich with big sonar ears.
Okay.
Yeah.
Lizardy ostrich.
But yeah, like they sat there and they developed this game and then they went ahead and decided to put an anime concurrent with it. And they actually got some really damn good names for it. Like the most prominent being the voice actress Mao, who is like really hot in the seiyuu field, as well as being, you know, the former Gokai Yellow from Gokaiger.
Also, it has Tomokazu Sugita as the hunter because he is in everything.
Yeah. So it's like it had this really great pedigree, and like me and Hobbs started trying to watch it because we're both Monster Hunter fans and we got like, gotta support the base, man. And it's just like, I think we made, what, 7 episodes in?
Is before? It kind of like how the Pokemon anime is? It's just completely catering to children.
It
not
is.
Not trying to be
pretty much
deep or anything. Okay, yeah.
Like, the only time I ever got kind of like goosebumps at it was like, at the very end when they talk about like, whatever monster hatched this week and like, the proper Monster Hunter theme would start up, you know, like Proof of a Hero. It's like, dun 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 dun. Yeah, I'm just like, ooh. And then you remember, oh yeah, we gotta go back to the kids.
Well, I don't know if you would agree with me, but I saw the first episode, and that was enough for me. Like, I thought...
I don't blame you.
I saw so many cliches.
Yeah.
Like I said, painfully shonen.
And like, it's one thing that it's for kids, and then it's another thing that it's bad.
Yeah, it's one of those, like, it did not do very well in Japan at all. Like, the game didn't sell that well, so it's not going to get localized over here, which sucks, because the game is actually decent.
And the 3DS is region locked. If it were on the Vita, then we could just import it and play it on a non-region locked system.
It's kind of
but
like one of
thank
those shows
you, Nintendo.
That they kind of like threw together, I'm guessing. Just like, whatever, it's fucking make a kid's show.
That's
like,
exactly what
like,
it
we have
is.
Enough money, we can make a fucking kid show
yes.
out of
yeah.
it. Like,
that's what it was.
Probably got Sugita on the fact that he most likely plays Monster Hunter.
More than likely,
cause
yeah. Cause
he
like,
voices Ragna the Blood Edge in BlazBlue, and he's actually pretty damn good with Ragna.
Yeah, so they probably got him on, like, hey, Game Otaku, you want some free Monster Hunter stuff? Come on over here. Ha ha ha, you must not voice act this thing for like 50 episodes.
Well, the hunter isn't in it that often, though.
True that.
Because he plays the Longsword Hunter.
Yeah, as I remember, yeah.
Yeah. I pointed it out obnoxiously as soon as I recognized the voice.
Yeah, true that. But yeah, I mean, like, there's a lot to that Monster Hunter has to offer, other than, like, a really horrible anime show. but it's also one of the most unforgiving, like, series around. It's very much in, like...
What was your pet name for it again? Like, the My Waifu Armor Class or whatever?
My Waifu?
I can't remember what you called it.
Oh, God. Like, I can't remember it either. But it is one of those, like, memorable. You know...
We usually throw very around Fashion Hunting.
Fashion Hunter... Generations,
yeah. But so generally, it's a hardcore dress-up game,
pretty much. Yeah,
yeah, because like one of the whole points of Monster Hunter is that you don't like gain levels per se. What you have to do is hunt more powerful monsters to get more powerful gear.
Oh, yeah, I've played it before.
Yeah, so you can like progress upwards and upwards. Well, you know, once you start getting really up there, it starts becoming less about okay, what things are going to give me really good stats versus oh my god, this thing is really fucking frilly. This doesn't match my colors. I cannot do this set. Mm-hmm. But, like, it gives you protection against Elytron. Fuck that shit.
About that.
Yeah.
It's not pretty.
It's not cute. You can't fight crime or monsters if you're not cute.
Exactly. I'm glad that Ellie gets it.
Yeah.
And the thing is, of course, it's an action RPG, so if you've got your, you know, timing down, you know what you're doing, you really don't need armor. Shit, there are quests where they send you against one of the strongest monsters in the game in your skivvies.
That's so silly.
Yeah. Yeah, like I said, you know, it's Monster Hunter is, like, really fun shit.
Moving on.
Poor Jason, like, he has, like, been out in the cold this whole time, and he's just like, I can't do anything with this Monster Hunter. I don't have anything to work with. So, yeah, let's actually, like, we'll actually transition a little bit. I'm going to let you take the lead on this one, Rom, because there's actually something you've been wanting to talk about for this week regarding game stuff.
Yeah, I've seen what everyone's, like, favorite game of all time is, and, like, the one that you would go back and replay over and over again.
Oh, can I start?
Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, my favorite game of all time that I have played, not exaggerating, at least probably, like, 20 to 30 times... or whatever, is Paper Mario.
Mm.
I fucking love that game. It is the perfect game to me. I've been really disappointed with, like, the, like, Sticker Star. I heard Color Splash wasn't as good. Because, I mean, Paper Mario has you know, the Thousand Year Door that was a really good sequel to it. But, I really hope they make another one that's, like, as... Oh, I heard Paper Jam was okay. So I'm probably gonna pick that up. When I have the money for it. But yeah, that is my favorite game. I can play it over and over. I play it, like, at least, like, once a year. You know, I can play it over and over and over and over again.
Alright, what about you, Dan?
So, as I've mentioned...
I know you're not much of a gamer, on occasions, you have played some
games. So, based on how much of a gamer I am, I would have to go all the way back to 99, 98... So think of that for a while.
I don't think that's all the way back, seeing as how most of us are in our 30s.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah. So think of 64, Nintendo 64. That's as far as I'm going. Okay. So I'm thinking GoldenEye. That's the game that I would play over and over and over again.
Oh, dude, remember the you could get, like, the big head and the slap fights?
Yes,
oh,
yes.
God, that was so good.
That was, the thing that I like to do the most is... do the invisible cheat and start fucking with everybody, like shooting them or
that's like a fun game
them.
To play
it's
with
a fun
friends.
Game
yeah.
Yeah, exactly, like you go into the Aztec temple and you start like and then you have the mines that you can place in certain corners and then you set up traps. It's fun.
Yeah,
that's the game that I would play.
What about you?
As far as the game that I would play over and over again, that is definitely a toss-up between Champions of Norrath on PS2 and Bloodborne, honestly.
Nice.
Because Champions of Norrath, it had the...
We didn't say, like, go back and start a new character over and over again. We just said go back.
I've cleared Bloodborne plenty. But the thing is, with Champions of Norrath, it had the Diablo-style gameplay, but it was actually custom-made for a console, as opposed to being a sloppy port like most versions of Diablo have been. And it had the EverQuest pedigree behind it, which I actually didn't play much EverQuest besides EverQuest 2, which crafting in EverQuest 2 was fucking great. It's almost like you got into a fight with the crafting table. You're sitting there cooking and, oh no, my cookies are burning. Well, I'm going to throw in a pot of butter. Special ability, go. It's no longer burning. Awesome cookies.
If only it was that easy.
But, yeah, definitely a toss-up between Bloodborne and Champions of Norrath. The sequel to Champions of Norrath was pretty neat, but it was one of those that, hey, this came out, I might as well play it. Did not have half the impact the first one did. And while I would love to see more Bloodborne in the form of a sequel, I don't think it needs a sequel.
Probably not.
And that's all I have to say on the matter. Okay. Your turn, Billy.
Mine is like probably the obvious one, which would be Zelda Ocarina of Time. Mainly because, like, you know, back in the day, of course, growing up, like, I mean, it, like, I got my 64 as a Christmas present. Didn't have a PlayStation, didn't have an SNES or anything like that. So the 64 was my first, like, true console that I actually owned. And I remember, like, when I sat there and, like, went to Best Buy and paid in, you know, the $80 for the fucking Zelda cartridge. And I took that thing home and, like, that was all I had at the time. It was, like, Zelda and Star Fox 64.
Oh, Lord.
So, like, when Zelda came in, I was just like, ooh, wow, you know, I'm like... So, I think, like, I got to the point where, like, I fully got all the hearts, took down all the Poes, and I, like, sat there and, like, completely beat the game. It took me about a month to do so because, you know, I was in school at the time.
Yeah.
But then the crazy part was that then I went through and did the second and third save files and completely wiped everything through on that. And then I started doing a deal where, like, I was completely obsessed with playing through Ganon's Tower over and over and over again. So for the next, like, 6 to 8 months, I did nothing but go home and play Ganon's Tower. I even made a VHS recording of myself playing through Ganon's Tower.
That is
so
adorable.
That when I wasn't playing the game or I didn't have access to the 64.
It's like football players where they record their sessions so they can go back and see what they did wrong.
That's exactly, okay. That's exactly what it was. I would sit there and, like, I recorded it so I could sit there and, like, look back and it was like, okay, like, this is what I did here. All right, I took Ganon down at this point. All right, I need to make sure to use a Biggeron sword right over here. And it's just like, so yeah, it was like basically me, like, armchair analyzing myself.
Hilarious. Little Billy, how old were you? 14, 15?
Oh, no, like, I was like 17, 18 at the time. Oh,
okay, so yeah, you weren't little anymore.
I remember I didn't play Ocarina of Time until, like, just a couple of years ago because, you know, I'm 10 years younger than everyone in the room. So I was a little baby. Not a baby,
you
but, you know, I was a little
baby.
Kid. Oh my God. I was a little kid when Ocarina of Time came out, and I rented it from Video Works, I think it was.
I've never actually played it.
Well,
I didn't own an N64 or any of that stuff until, like, a few years ago.
But I rented the game. And I was like, my parents never let me watch horror movies when I was little, so I started up and I'm like, oh yes, this is gonna, everyone's talking about this at school, you know. And it turned into nighttime, and all the zombies came out, and it scared me so bad I turned it off and never played it until years later.
My parents were the same. I wasn't allowed to watch. I did it, but I wasn't allowed to.
Yeah, so it really scared me when, like, all the skeletons came out, because I was like, I had a fear of skeletons at the time, you know, so...
Well, I saw the movie Child's Play back when I was probably about 6 or 7.
Oh, that is insane.
And I had a My Buddy doll. I swore to God thing was crawling under my bed.
Yeah.
But, yeah, like, I mean, yeah, Ocarina was always the one that I came back to, like, every time. Like, all the way up until, like, I think at one point I finally, like, sold off my 64. And, yeah, it was just kind of like, because I felt, I was like, all right, I've accomplished everything I need to do with Ocarina of Time. I can finally move on to Final Fantasy VII.
Like, so Rum, what's your favorite game of all time?
Oh my God. King's Quest VI is my all-time favorite game. It was a PC game, old school adventure. I skipped from, like, for consoles, I skipped from, Super Nintendo all the way up to PS2. Mm-hmm. So that whole generation, I didn't play a single console game because I was playing old school adventure games on my PC. But yeah, I've played that game I don't know how many times. And I remember almost every solution to the puzzles. And that will be the game I'm playing this coming up Wednesday whenever I do my stream.
Woohoo!
Yeah, so...
Nice.
Look forward to that.
Quite the adept plug. I say a round of applause.
Yes.
Yes, golf clap.
Yes.
That deserves a golf clap.
Bravo.
Yeah, basically just to, like, let everybody know in the cast right now, we're making, like, a couple, like, additions. The first one's going to be, you know, the... what are we, like, Rum Plays?
Yeah, Rum Plays.
Yeah, we're going to be adding Rum Plays on Wednesdays. So make sure to check that out.
Rum Plays Wednesdays, yeah!
Rum Plays Stillskin.
Oh, lordy. So...
So bad.
But so good.
Yeah.
I love
puns. Speaking of so good, it's now...
Not too close.
Okay, I won't do it too close.
Yeah.
Yeah. So now it's time for a Dance Corner Explosions and Good Times. Wow, that was a lot of decibel levels right there.
Yeah.
That's why I said not too close.
That's an addition.
Yeah.
That is an addition.
That happens.
A warning to all of our longtime listeners, you may wish to turn down your headphones.
After the fact.
Well, we'll probably have to put this in the description.
Yeah.
Trigger warning.
I can adjust it later.
This is true. But yeah, it's time for Don's Corner, where our wonderful delivery man once again will go over a series that kind of is overlooked by a lot of the larger anime community.
Everyone.
Yeah, as in everyone.
Except lonely, horny girls.
Exactly. But they'll just go play the visual novel version instead of watching the anime.
Or fair getting enough. A boyfriend.
And that's
if
the point.
If they're playing visual novels, probably not so much.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. They're not getting a boyfriend. They're playing Diabolic Lovers.
Yeah, that's right. And that's the point of my corner, because I'm arguing that it's not meant only for girls. It could be, but there's also something.
Also, the guys who are into other guys type things, or
what that exists.
Says the person that played Hat a Full Boyfriend.
Oh, yeah. I want to fuck birds.
Fuck birds? Okay.
Well, that's bestiality, not
homosexuality. We're already, like, going wildly off the tracks.
It's fine. It's fine. I don't care. that's the point of the podcast.
He'll kill us all in our sleep, but he doesn't care.
No.
No, just sick Kenzie on your balls.
Okay, Kenzie. Change of plans. So this episode is number 4, and so by this time I would comfortably say that there's a narrative to the whole story about how the female character is not the protagonist. It's the male characters and the male psychology behind it. And so at the opening of this episode, we see the female character trying to find a phone because she wants to communicate with her father, which is important. I think it's relevant because, again, we're talking about the male psychology. So we're listening. We're now hearing about the importance of the father figure. And the phone is broken. So again, this is important because you see that the cord is cut, and again, it's a powerful symbol in my opinion, a metaphor that the communication is lost, it's cut, and so there's a character that shows up at that particular moment, and she has to go upstairs to the roof because the character has taken her backpack, which, I mean, it's it's trivial that the character takes the backpack, but it's important that the girl has to go to the roof to get her backpack, because in my opinion, I would say that she's going to the roof because she's trying to go upstairs. So she's trying to have communication with the higher parts of the body. If we're talking about the psychology, I would say that this is an attempt of the feminine trying to communicate with the male, the masculine, and it's confirmed because she runs into a character that we have not seen before, and he's reciting a poem, and she overhears this poem, and she's caught eavesdropping, and so the male character teases her, and the male character is trying to suck her blood, which we have already talked about what that means, in my opinion.
What does that mean, in your opinion?
Listen to the podcast. Yeah.
Yeah, the gist of it is basically like that sucking the blood is
the mother, the...
Well, it's also about like it's a lot of it's rape, because it's essentially, you know, a symbolism for that.
Yeah, the fang goes into the neck.
It's unwilling penetration.
Exactly.
It's not exactly a long leap to make.
No. They're really neck romancers there.
And nice there goes one. Rome with the pun.
Yeah.
Boy, is that a humdinger.
Right. So
if I may for a second, have you drawn any parallels between Beauty and the Beast in this?
Yes. So it's again, like in the case of the Beauty and the Beast, the Beast is redeemed by Beauty. So it's a supernatural or unnatural or like something that is not human. In this case, like the Beast paralleling the vampire.
Though in Beauty and the Beast, the Beast's quote-unquote ugliness was external, but from what I gather about these vampire guys, all of their ugliness is internal.
Yes, and which, again, would support my thesis that it's psychological.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you for bringing that up. When the character tries to rape her, she runs away, and we see her actually leaving the house, which I had already mentioned that it was a symbol for the psyche itself, the male psyche. And so she tries to leave, and the male character chases her down to a payphone, and so she goes to the payphone and she starts making a call, and the character who is chasing her actually answers her at the payphone, and she mocks her and tells her that she's never going to be able to escape, and he's across the street from the payphone looking at her as he is talking to her with his cell phone. So he captures her, and like suddenly, like magically, there's a huge TV on the street, like broadcasting this news about a politician. And so suddenly both forget that one is chasing the other, and so the female character asks who this person is on TV, and he says, "That's my father, the object of my hatred." So again, it's going back to the male figure and this idea that there's something very, very wrong, very damaged, Yes. And she faints. So again, we see that whenever the male figure or the appearance of masculinity happens, the female character either faints or passes out or falls asleep or something like that. So she wakes up in the house again, so she's back in the house, and the next scene, we see her leave the house again and go to a church, which conveniently was very close to the house, apparently. So she's praying to her heavenly father, again, the father figure. And we see the male character come in to the church and tease her again and tell her, and he says to her, he tells her that nobody's listening. So the last exchange that we see between the male character and the female character is him telling her that nobody has achieved anything based on beliefs only. So it takes more than just believing in something. You have to do it yourself. So that, to me, means that what the episode itself is saying, the guy who, the creator of the show, whatever, is saying that if you want to be a better person, if you want to solve whatever issue it is that you have, it's not enough just to believe and say, you know, like, if I believe in this, if I pray hard enough, it's just gonna happen. It's not that easy. You have to do some serious personal work. That is not going to be just as easy as reciting Our Father, like praying.
Yeah.
And that's how I would conclude this corner of mine.
Yay.
Yay.
Nerd claps.
That's right.
Americans clap at everything.
We are stupid seals.
Yeah.
You're like seals. That's adorable.
Give me a fish and I'll suck your cock.
Oh my god.
And once again, there goes Hans, like, taking it way too far.
Do we have
You're
fish?
Welcome. Someone has to. That offer
off.
Expired.
I could go to Long John Silver's.
Yeah. Oh boy. Get some fish sticks.
Oh my god.
Fish sticks, yep.
Fuck yeah.
It's a gay fish.
Anywho. At this point, like, we're gonna talk some dank anime, and so who finally caught the first episodes of My Hero Academia and Attack on Titan?
Ooh, me, pick me.
I caught the second one.
I'm watching the first season with Dylan of Attack on Titan, so we're almost. I mean, I've already seen it, but he hasn't, so I'm trying to.
You're trying to indoctrinate him?
Yeah, and I'm trying to, like, refresh myself before I watch the new season, so...
Yeah, I think I'll have to do that, yeah.
Yeah.
Unfortunately,
yeah.
The dub sucks it on, so sorry. Yeah. But the show's really good.
Yeah, it's kind of unfortunate.
I wouldn't know any better.
Yeah, like, it's kind of, like... I have become more of a proponent of dubs over the last few years, but the Attack on Titan dub is one of those
really
instances
bad.
Of just, like... What were you guys smoking? Like, do you really have to be contracted to use only these particular actors?
Yeah.
Yes, like, I can see... Like, I recognize that voice in everything.
Well, they are having the sex with the bees and the eagles, so...
Hot. What? Hot. It's a misheard lyrics of the first opening. Having the sex with the bees and the eagles!
Yeah. Now,
I'll have to show
you.
It, damn it, y'all
it's
ruined.
It's gonna be stuck in your head. In the second,
oh, don't worry, Ellie. I'll
opening.
Send you a video called Otaku Lyrics. It's a bunch of
Lord.
Stupid, misheard lyrics that are actually quite funny. My personal favorite is it's actually supposed to be "Let me be with you," but it sounds like "Let me pee with you."
Yeah.
Oh my god.
Yeah,
was,
I don't know.
What was the second opening? It was something about
Korea. You can't make me go to Korea. You turn on my dick.
Oh, boy.
But yeah, Attack on Titan this week was pretty good. Lots of...
Sasha being badass.
Yeah,
the potato, like...
Potato girl! Yeah, potato girl!
Potato yeah. Queen gets my vote for waifu for laifu.
But her laifu might not be lasting.
She is an Attack on Titan character, so yeah, none of them
like
are really...
It's like Game of Thrones. It's like, no one's safe.
Well, you know how it was originally supposed to end, don't you?
No.
The obvious solution of we're all fucked and they're continuing to encroach upon us.
The only ones that are, like, guaranteed to survive so far are, like, Eren and Mikasa and, what was his name?
And Tsukasa. Sorry.
Armin?
Huh?
Armin Whisper?
Mikasa, Tsukasa.
I got it.
Swing.
Bazinga!
That's bingo.
It's a Mexican thing.
Yeah, like, as somebody who's, like, pretty far ahead in the story at this point...
Yeah, I'm not, I don't like spoilers.
So. I'm just kind of like, I don't know, I'm LOLing.
As has been said in previous podcasts, when I had to step
so
out of the room...
So have you read
the
manga?
Like I said, I've been keeping ahead.
Nah.
But yeah, this week's Attack on Titan was really good. My Hero Academia, though. Oh my god.
Yeah, that hot jazz is picking up.
Are you a fangirl?
It's fucking awesome. Yeah, like, I'm like a fangirl when David Tennant shows up on Doctor Who.
Oh, Lord. He's not even cute.
He's not.
He looks like a bird.
Well, Hatoful Boyfriend did do really well, so maybe chicks are into birds.
Well... They are chicks.
It's hit the fuck.
But do you get the fuck the trash dove?
I wish.
But yeah, like,
and
yeah.
Just keeps doing that all throughout.
But yeah, like, My Hero Academia is starting to pick up really well. And, like, it's actually kind of an odd point, you know, because...
The sports festival.
The sports festival. Yeah. Yeah, I know you're pretty much waiting for that one, Adon.
Which one?
My Hero Academia.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, you need to catch up.
Yeah. Like, you made it all the way through the end of the first season, right?
Yes, I did.
Okay.
Oh,
that's
right. He thought it was sub only waiting for the dubs, but
yeah.
It's simul dubs.
Yeah.
They're putting out the dubs at the exact same time they're putting the subs out.
So I guess I need to watch this then, because I thought it was like for kids.
No.
It's one of the new Shonen Jump series that have really skyrocketed with the ending of Bleach and Naruto.
Big three.
One of the three will never end.
One Piece
Shonen
is eternal.
Show, but
it's really good.
Yeah, I mean, it could be for kids, but they're taking it to a more mature place.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Not only that, but like
then.
The particular hero of this one is much more craftier than a lot of other Shonen heroes.
Okay.
In a world full of heroes, he has no powers. Starting.
Oh. He's Batman.
Yeah, well, not really.
Not quite.
Oh.
Not
he
quite.
He doesn't have the money.
So,
oh, that's right.
Yeah, but watch it.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's really good stuff. And
was it the first or second episode that brings me to tears every fucking time?
Yeah.
Was it when All Might starts talking to him? I think it was the second episode.
It's the second episode.
Oh, yeah, second episode,
yeah.
The speech.
He acknowledges him.
Yeah, he's having a flashback kind of thing.
Yeah.
Oh, am I going to cry?
Yeah, probably. It's so good.
I don't know. Like,
really?
It's one of those like really
not
uplifting moments.
Cry, not sad cry.
Okay.
It's like,
not elfin lead cry.
Yeah.
I get goosebumps every time I see that episode.
Yeah,
okay.
It's not, you're not gonna feel like you did when you watched Death Parade.
Oh,
no,
thank God.
No, no, it's not.
The sadness every goddamn episode. I literally cried at every fucking episode on
Death
Parade.
Who recommended Death Note? Death Parade.
You did. You evil monster.
And it's like, this is why it's even crazier that Adon's actually a fan of My Hero Academia, because normally you don't go for, like, shonen shows like this.
Not like this. I had the same impression that Ellie did, because the
title... Oh, it's just a kid's
show. It's like Naruto, like... I would have
enjoyed it when I
was, like, 14 or something.
Exactly.
You know?
No,
like,
this
Fruits Basket or something
so
like that.
Freaking good.
Fruits Basket's so good.
I know. But what I liked about My Hero Academia was that, in my opinion, they do a more fairly decent job at the evolution of the main character than other other
shows. Okay, cool.
Yeah, you really see the main character grow. You really feel for the
guy once like they show like what happens when he was a kid, when everybody else was getting powers and he was still powerless. And, it's a really good show. You should check it out.
Yeah, definitely. And of course, like, you know, like we got Berserk on the horizon, so I know Hobbs, you're pretty stoked for that, and Adon.
Yes, because I have very strong opinions.
Really? I remember from a couple of podcasts.
Yeah, I know.
Say what?
Oh man, shocking! Shocking.
Yeah,
I do not feel strongly about this.
Well, you do have your neutral gray dice that you play use on Pathfinder days. So.
Tell my wife I said, okay.
No,
that's right.
If we don't make it, tell my wife I said.
Hello.
Thank you for fucking up my delivery. When I'm making a goddamn joke, wait for it.
I can't.
Oh, man.
It's called comedic timing. Eventually, you will learn it.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That's so funny.
Tell my wife I said...
That's debatable.
Skinny penis.
I was waiting for the skinny penis part to come in. Oh yeah, and of course, like some other really good stuff is that Kobayashi's Dragon Maid is wrapping up.
Oh yeah.
Sad face, personally, and Your Name is actually making its this is its second weekend run in theaters. This time they're doing both the dubbed and the sub version.
My Name?
It's literally named Your Name.
Yeah.
I think it translates to Kimi no Namae.
Something like that. Yeah.
Is that a movie or a show?
Movie. Okay. Came out, it's like pretty much like the highest grossing animated film in Japan now.
Okay. Is it going to come here to Dallas, do you know?
Yeah, it's it did its sub premiere a couple weeks ago, and then this weekend they're showing the dub.
Okay.
Along with the sub and some screenings.
I'm guessing Angelica?
Yeah, Angelica, AMC, a few of them
Alamo
got it.
Alamo Draft House, maybe? Alamo Draft House sometimes.
Yeah, they've been doing a lot of
I didn't see the Draft House and Funimation's listings.
Well, what movie did they do recently? I think it was the Sword Art Online.
Yes.
Recently. Oh, yep.
Yes.
Yep.
Ordinal Scale.
Yeah. I still need to see that. But I remember when we went to go see Wolf Children, it was pretty much just a furry fuckfest at the beginning.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, the beginning was like that one bit where they're in the bedroom and, like, dude starts to, like, you know, just, like, time to go to town. Oh, well, I'm not going to give a fuck about shifting back. And, like, that part was entirely cringeworthy. Was like, weird. Everybody in the theater was just like, oh, no! No!
Yeah,
but
They went there.
Yeah. But the rest of the flick, though, was like...
That was so sad. Yeah. I cried really hard.
Yeah.
I'm such a weenie.
Well, I mean, like, the Wind Rises is pretty brutal, too.
Let's start calling you Oscar Mayer, then.
Yeah. Hell yeah.
Oh, good times, good times. But yeah, like, as the spring anime season comes on, if there's anything that you guys listening out there are interested in, anything that you guys think we should check out, you know, drop us a line, because we're always interested in checking out dank new animus and all that nice little jazz.
Also, if you happen to find anything from the Edo period, it is sadly missing from my diet, and I think I am actually fiending.
Have you seen Drifters?
No.
It's
a smorgasbord of time periods, and it's not quite the pure fix that I need.
Okay.
That and, like, I think you're almost caught up on Gintama episodes, aren't you?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's probably also helped. That's not helping your situation there.
No, it isn't.
So, have you heard anything about if or when One Punch Man Season 2 is supposed to be coming out?
It's in development, but I haven't heard anything. Like, I know it's supposed to be, like, either later this year.
Oh, dude, really? Already?
Yeah, because, I mean, like, the first one was
it was a huge success.
Yeah, it was, like,
I mean, like, it's coming so fast. Like,
yeah, well, they fast-tracked it because the first series was just so
big. A breakout hit.
Yeah.
Yeah, like a lot of normies really like One Punch Man.
Like,
yeah.
Bill Burr.
The Bill Burr thing you posted the other day.
Yeah, like, if whoever's listening, if you get a chance, just search Bill Burr One Punch Man. It's from his podcast that he does every week. And he goes on a gigantic tangent about how he loves One Punch Man and into it from, like, the first three episodes.
That's funny.
He is a funny, funny man.
He is.
Yeah, it's like, it's a really awesome bit. And, yeah, you guys should definitely check that out.
He's talking about how the crab guy in the first episode was, like, the top one percenters that, because they're just stuffing their faces, like, oh, yeah, I'm going to go eat some crab.
Yeah, like, he actually goes, like, really deep into it, and there's some places that I would have never thought. And it was just like, well, at the same time, though, and making it really fucking hilarious.
He tried to say that the mosquito girl was, like, a blood-sucking gold digger. And
yeah. Yeah, it's just like...
Women,
just,
am so, I right? Oh, okay.
Tell me, Dan, in the dub, how is Saitama's delivery of his puns?
They're okay.
Actually, yeah, somebody who's watched quite a few episodes, like, bits of the dub, like, his English boy VA is pretty good. Genos' VA is fucking hilarious.
Well, when he fights the mosquito girl and he makes the pun, mosquitoes suck, just that dad delivery really sells the character. Does he have that in English?
I think so, okay. Yeah. Well, yeah, just to let everybody know, One Punch Man is actually now on Netflix in dub and sub format. So for those who didn't get a chance to check it out,
it was on Hulu.
Hulu.
Oh, okay.
Because the main deal was initially One Punch Man was exclusive to Daisuke, except for like they did license it out to Hulu, but now with the advent of the Blu-ray coming out, they finally put it up on Netflix.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. So yeah, really good times. I mean, a really fun series. Like if you haven't gotten a chance to check it out, or you don't want to like deal with the commercials that are on Daisuke and Hulu. Now you can check it out on Netflix and just binge it.
I do need to go back and rewatch that series because it was so fucking hilarious.
And the opening, man, The Hero by Jam Project. Listen to it, jam out.
I saw somebody went into, what was it, Fallout 4 and made a One Punch Man character.
Yeah.
Where, they boosted his strength up so high, he was one punching Death Claws.
Oh my god.
Yeah, it was one of the most hilarious things. I remember that video too. Yeah, it's like I said, it was like One Punch Man was one of those really crazy moments of time. Like, you know, I talk about this a lot, you know, about anime, the anime that will save anime. And I think if there was an anime that actually managed to pull it off in that particular year, it was One Punch Man.
Yeah.
Because when that shit came out, everybody was fucking talking about it. From all circles, it was like...
It's something everyone can enjoy, and it's actually, but it's still good. It's not catering to, like, the lowest common denominator in that sense. It's something that everyone can enjoy that is still a solid show.
Yeah, and that's, like, I attribute that to the strength of its mangaka, one.
Oh, yeah.
And also, like, not only that, but, like, Mob Psycho 100, the sister series.
Oh, yeah.
That show is good, too.
Which, speaking of... did you make it all the way through that yet?
Not yet.
How far are you at right now?
Because I was telling y'all earlier that I have the Netflix syndrome, which is...
He wants to watch it all
To see it all at once. I can't wait.
But it's
done. I think the dub is now done,
okay.
So you should be able to finish binging
it. So now that it's done, I'll finish watching it.
Yeah. Good, so we'll need a report on that next week.
Yes.
Yeah, we'll need an in-depth, like... written report at least.
Yes.
Actually, no. That's your Don's Corner next week.
Yeah,
you need to talk about one. You need to talk about Mob Psycho 100.
Deep psychological analysis
of
on
Mob Psycho 100.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because yes, he has a lot of psychological issues.
Yeah.
Yeah. Book it. We got it ready to go.
And the naked fellow Esper. What is that? From a Jungian perspective, what do naked men used for comedy mean?
Oh, lordy.
I will look into that.
Save it for next
week. Yes.
Yes. At this point, we kind of want to, like, shift over a little bit to talking about, like, whatever random shit we're into this week. And, Rum, why don't you open this up?
Let's see. What we do this week? We played Pathfinder on Wednesday. That was pretty fun.
Yeah.
Posted as the NeviQuest for those that are curious to see the shenanigans of our fictional characters traipsing about a fictional setting.
Yeah, there were a lot of shenanigans.
Yeah.
Especially at the beginning, before, like when we first started recording.
That was less shenanigans and more us fucking around.
Yeah. That was really fun. though. I can't wait until our next game on the third.
Yeah, like, yeah, Nevi Quest will pretty much be like a monthly type deal.
But because of how next month falls, we'll do one on the 3rd and one on the 31st of May.
Yeah. Yeah, it's schedules and time permitting. We'll definitely be doing one on the 3rd, and then we should be able to do one on the 31st. That way we get it one in before Akon.
Which, if you want to explain Akon for those that aren't
may not know.
Yeah, they may not know.
Yeah, so yeah, like, Akon is like pretty much like the second biggest anime convention in the U.S. behind Anime Expo at this point. And they are going to be in Fort Worth this year.
At the convention center, not a hotel.
Yes, it's going to be so much fun. If you haven't watched the videos or like gone to Fort Worth, downtown Fort Worth, and the convention center, it's amazing.
I'm just going to get drunk off my ass.
Yes.
Oh, hell yeah.
This will be Jason's big party event this year. Yeah.
And it's a perfect place to do that because in front of the convention centers, they have this huge green space called the Water Gardens. Mm. And they have like different, they decided to do a lot of different architecture experiments with it.
Hmm.
So they have like fountains and green areas, so you can hide, like you can get, you know, just schmammered.
Yeah.
And go.
I like that. I'm gonna use a schmammered.
Yeah.
It's like shit faced hammered all
yes,
at once.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah, you're gonna get
schmammered in a corner and stay there and like have a blast. Because it's huge. It's huge, huge
place. It's one
place.
Big party, basically. Akon has turned into one giant 4-day, 24-hour party.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So, Ellie, what's been on your mind this week?
Well, since I've been sick, I was able to watch some animus. And I watched, I'm almost done with Gangsta. It came out in 2015. I haven't read the manga,
The fucking second season?
Oh, yeah, because it's really good. It's about two mercenaries who they are contracted by the mafia and the police to do jobs. Yeah, it's all about like, you know, gangsters. Like that's, you know, it's what it is about the gangsters, the mob, like drugs, you know, stuff like that. And
prostitution.
Prostitution. You know, all that fun stuff. And the main plot is they found the police found a warehouse full of bodies, and they have no idea who did it. So it's about who's behind that and like the problems that the two main characters face. And what's really interesting about one of the main characters is deaf. So it's a really interesting. He'll talk sometimes, and it's you know how like he can't hear. So it's like they put effort into making him more realistic. In that regard, so
I can vouch for their good effort to make it very realistic because I of course could only see the dubbed. I saw the dubbed,
yeah,
and they do an amazing deaf job. It sounds a little bad.
It's like because he doesn't sound very good.
No,
like he you know
no, he sounds deaf.
Yeah, he sounds deaf. They did a really good job on that and. But he's still, you know, like, he's not portrayed as, like, you know, a lot of, like, handicapped characters
like
would
mentally
be, like, dumb or something. No, he's a fucking badass.
Yeah.
Like, he's so awesome. Like, oh my god.
He is the one of the protagonists.
Yeah.
I mean, he is a real protagonist in the show.
So, to either one of you that have seen both, how does it compare to Black Lagoon?
I have not seen Black Lagoon.
That's a very good question. Compared to what, like, what do you mean?
Well, how similar in tone, how similar in content? If I liked one, would I like the other?
Basically,
I haven't seen Black Lagoon, but if you like really dark shit, like, I mean, it's very dark. The characters are pretty, like...
Oh no, Ellie, I'm 100% moe all the time.
But, they
like
are... Like
your character, like your face on the Nevi Devla group picture.
Oh yeah,
the super moe
with that ketchup.
Which, by the way, you still haven't brought enough moe for the entire class.
Yeah,
I know. I thought you guys wouldn't want that.
I directly asked you for one.
I forgot. I'm sorry. I gotta do that.
That's flattering.
So
I'm hurt.
Having watched both, I would have to say that from what I've seen, because I haven't seen the second season. And it really all depends on the second season. Because the first season starts off really good. But I would have to say that the first season of Black Lagoon compared to the first season of Gangster, I would say Black Lagoon is better. Just based on the characters and the development. They fall into cliches in Gangster a couple of times.
Fair enough. But the biggest thing I was asking is, I watched Black Lagoon because I was recommended, hey, if you like Cowboy Bebop, you'll like Black Lagoon. And I did. But who doesn't like Cowboy Bebop?
Mm-hmm.
So I was thinking, if you like Black Lagoon, you'll love Gangsta, yay or nay.
You wouldn't love it, but you would like it. I would say.
Fair enough. I will give it a watch based on that,
yeah.
Then.
Yeah, yeah.
And on that note, Adon, what are you into this week?
So my anime that I don't know if it's happened to any of y'all before, but there were a couple of times where I started watching an anime and then life happened and I had to stop watching it, and yeah, so
quite a few.
Yeah. And so Hunter x Hunter is that anime. So I'm going back to that.
Didn't it get short?
It got cut short, and that was the thing. So I'm watching the 2011 thing, the remake that they're doing, and it's coming out really well, because it's like the first season, and I think Hunter x Hunter is the only show that I can wait for at this point in time.
Fun fact: the mangaka of Hunter x Hunter is a huge Monster Hunter fan.
Okay. And besides his back problems, that's also the major reason why he'll take breaks.
Yeah, I think we discussed that in an earlier podcast, if I remember correctly.
Yep, yeah. And also, of course, the creator of Yu Yu Hakusho, which was the other reason why he gets so much ability to just like, all right, taking a break, Shonen Jump. See y'all in a little bit.
Yeah, so I'm still on that because the characters are pretty engaging.
Yeah.
They have good stories behind them. The story itself is, you know, compelling.
Yeah. Well, yeah, definitely good times. And, you know, Hobbs, I know you're wanting to talk about something that's really important to you, which is Camp Nanarimo.
Getting your pet spayed or neutered.
Okay.
Oh, wait. Shit. I read the wrong liner notes. I'm sorry. Yeah, National Novel Writing Month, which, as you might have guessed, is a month set aside trying to write 50,000 words of a novel. It's generally a challenge that people who either are authors or pretend to be an author, like myself, partake in. Stow it in your ass. Seriously, one more fucking interruption.
Also,
and I will dick stab you in the eye.
Also known as NaNoWriMo, for those of you.
Yes, they do Camp National Novel Writing Month, which is actually twice in the year, in April, this month, and July, the month of my birth. So I generally participate in those. Originally, I was going to write a story called Take Me Home, in which a character dies and then sets off to say goodbye to her family. Instead, since I realized I needed to do more prep work before I actually write that, there's me being Freudian again. I decided to go with The Hidden World, the novel that actually got me into this whole crazy business of writing novels. I am also still doing Flash Fiction Fridays, which is plugging along with the Prism Chaser story. We're about halfway through the first arc, so give it a read. Let me know what you think.
All right, and I will finish up. And my main, like, I'm actually going to take it in a completely different direction, because my main thing this week is the new Dreamcatcher single came out. And, yeah, I'm, like, standing big time. Just to give a little bit of explanation about this, like, Dreamcatcher is a K-pop girl group that just recently started putting out hot tunes over the last few months. This is what's called their comeback single, in which normally when a K-pop group, like, they'll put out, like, a song, single, album, whatnot, spend a few months off the doing hibernating or whatnot, and then when they get ready to put out their new stuff, it's always called a comeback. So that's what's going on in this case. And what really makes, like, Dreamcatcher kind of stand out from a lot of the other K-pop groups is that they actually decided to go for more of a J-rock sound, which is something, like, it's really standard for all of us because we all listen to anime music and stuff all the time. But in Korea, this is something that's almost never touched. Like, J-rock bands are just really not that popular, with the exception of, like, you know, two or three groups. And even then, a lot of them for the longest time, like, didn't even really necessarily play their instruments. Kind of like the Monkees kind of situation.
Yeah.
So, yeah, a group like this actively trying to come out and with a rock-based sound is kind of rare, and as a result of that, like, not only that, but they have what's called a horror concept, too. Like, and, like, their videos are actually depicted as witches who passed away and all this nice little jazz. So it's
sort of like the whole baby metal thing where they're, like,
worshiping. Yeah, like, it's the fox god. Yeah, it's kind of, like, really reminiscent of baby metal. Nowhere near as hard, because baby metal is pretty much, like, avant-garde slash speed metal slash power metal, and like very unapologetic about it, whereas Dreamcatcher is much more tame. Like, it's basically like you would listen to like both of their main singles and you would think that this would be something on a Naruto OP. You know, so it's got that kind of a sound to it.
They are fighting dreamers.
Yes, but yeah, like it's just really refreshing. It's something I like a bunch, and that's why I like the group. Like, you know, I, like, bought both of their single, like, albums. So, yeah, it's really good stuff. If you haven't checked it out, you know, just go look them up on YouTube. So, yeah, that's my main thing that I've been into this week. So, on that note, we should actually go ahead and wrap things up for this week. Thank you guys for listening to us. If you ever want to get a hands of our podcast, for those of you who are accessing this through the website, just look us up on iTunes and Google Play. Or you can find us on RSS pretty easily. And of course, you know, we're at the nebbydoublegroup.wordpress.com. And you can find us even on Facebook as well.
The revolution will be podcasted.
Shaken, not stirred.
Yep.
Or it is being podcasted. I think present tense would be.
Anywho, guys, thank you very much. And good night and good luck.
All right. See you later.
Bye, guys.
Later.